When most people think of the Pinto, the first thing they think of is the fiery death recall. But what most people don't realize is that the Pinto totally dominated the subcompact market in the 1970s. Before we get too far into this, the first thing we should probably do is address the recall. The issue was that the fuel tank was mounted directly in front of the rear bumper, and in a hard rear-end collision, the tank could be ruptured, and sparks could ignite the leaking fuel and create a fire. This was not an unusual design element at the time, but it was worse on the Pinto for three reasons. First of all, the car's size. Because it was so much smaller than most cars of this period, the fuel tank was in a smaller space, and therefore more likely to be ruptured. And cars of this size were fairly unusual at the time, so if it wasn't a two-car collision, the likelihood was that it was going to be hit by a car that was twice its size and weight, meaning that the Pinto would take the brunt of the damage. The second thing that was against the Pinto was the high sales of the early models that had this issue. There were simply a significantly larger number of them on the road compared to other small cars, therefore increasing the chance of one being in an accident. But the biggest issue was Ford's handling of it. Ford was aware of the potential problem from the very beginning, and there were even internal memos discussing the problem. And even though the impact regulations that required bigger bumpers in the early 70s helped alleviate the problem, and Ford did a voluntary recall to add additional shielding to help resolve the problem, the recall didn't happen until after there were a number of incidents that led to lawsuits, which had brought the before-mentioned memos to the public's attention, which created a bunch of bad press, not just for the Pinto, but for Ford as a whole. But in spite of this, the Pinto was produced for 10 years with only minor changes and sold over 1 million units. In fact, in the early years, Ford sold more Pintos than any import brand sold cars in the United States. Let me reiterate that. Ford not only sold more Pintos than Toyota sold Corollas, but Ford sold more Pintos than Toyota sold cars in the U.S., selling over 350,000 cars its first year, and that number climbing above 450,000 following the fuel crisis. Now, if you're expecting me to say at this point that this all happened because the Pinto was such a great car, expect to be disappointed. The Pinto was the smallest, cheapest, most budget-oriented car Ford made, and it showed. It just happened that all of its competition was worse. At introduction, the Pinto came in both a fastback and a two-door station wagon body style. It came with two engine choices. A 1.6-liter four-cylinder rated at 75 horsepower gross, or 54 horsepower net, and a 2-liter four-cylinder, which at introduction was rated at 100 horsepower gross, and over its 10-year run had a net rating between 80 and 86 horsepower. Compared to its competition, it had more interior space, better handling, the 2-liter version tended to have better throttle response, and its acceleration was pretty average, with quarter-mile times in the neighborhood of about 19 seconds, give or take. But it also had an unusually low seating position, poor ride for an American car, although the wagon versions were better, and it was also considered noisy for an American car of that period. But Ford had met its objective as a car that was under 2,000 pounds for under $2,000. Its closest competitor was another all-new American subcompact introduced that year in the form of the Chevy Vega. The Vega was a little more stylish, a little more powerful, a little quicker, had a smoother ride and better seats, and although it was a little more expensive, earned itself the title of Car of the Year and managed to sell over 270,000 units the first year. But it also had severe noise and vibration issues and quickly proved itself to be unreliable. And there was a third new American subcompact car introduced that year as well, the AMC Gremlin. And although the Gremlin was comparable to the Pinto in size and price, it was a completely different animal, because it was essentially just a shortened version of AMC's compact Hornet The only engine options were the same two straight sixes that were available in the Hornet. And although this made it more powerful and quicker than the other cars in this segment, it also meant that it got the worst mileage. And AMC only sold 53,000 of them the first year, although that was enough to make it competitive with the imports. And imports were what these cars were aimed at, specifically European imports, because those were the cars that were controlling the segment previously. And the best-selling import was the Volkswagen Beetle. It was cheap, now could be had with a 60-horsepower flat four, and the 40-horsepower variants were some of the most economical cars on the road at the time, although the car was essentially about 30 years out of date already, which is why the whole gross power versus net power doesn't really pertain to this car, because it had none of the horsepower-stealing features you would expect on a car of the period. In fact, it had very few of the features that people expected at all. There was no power anything. There was no automatic transmission. It didn't even have a heater that worked very well. But it was still a better buy and sold better than most of the other European competition. Cars like the Opel Kadett, which were considered garbage right out of the showroom. In fact, one of the most flattering reviews of it at the time called it mediocre. And even worse was the Hillman Avenger, sold in the U.S. as the Plymouth Cricket, which was so bad that you're more likely to see a unicorn on the street than one of these. And the Japanese cars of the time were still struggling to beat their reputation as building terrible, unreliable products, sort of like Chinese cars now or Korean cars in the 80s. Toyota was just starting to build its reputation. And the Corolla was considered a well-built, terrible car. Terrible in the sense that it had poor handling, bad brakes, unacceptable wind and engine noise, and a useless back seat, and it wasn't capable of sustained interstate speeds. Datsun's 1200 had better handling and brakes, but was even noisier inside, and was still dealing with quality issues. Honda was barely even building cars, and the critics of the time didn't even compare the American products to these cars. Instead, they compared them to bigger, more powerful, more expensive cars, such as the Toyota Celica and the Opel Manta. Soon, the Pinto had more options, including a hatchback and a panel wagon. The 1.6 liter was dropped, and a more powerful 2.3 liter was added to the lineup, helping it catch up to the Vega in power and acceleration. By 1975, the price had climbed dramatically to almost $2,800, and in the face of newer competition, sales had dropped to around 210,000, still making it the best-selling car in the segment. And it was joined by a Mercury version called the Bobcat that added another 30,000 to 40,000 in sales. The Vega remained its closest competitor in spite of its growing reputation for reliability issues, which it dealt with partially by offering limited edition performance variants, such as the Stinger, the Cosworth, and the Monza, which would quickly spin off as a separate model, but it still managed to reach 200,000 in sales in 1975. Gremlin sales had remained relatively stable, dropping slightly, and although they would eventually offer a GM four-cylinder in an attempt to improve mileage, it wouldn't be until after they offered a V8 option. And by this point, Volkswagen had effectively tried to reinvent the wheel, replacing its rear-engine air-cooled flat fours with an all-new water-cooled front-engine, front-wheel drive inline four with the original Golf, known in the U.S. as the Rabbit. This car had numerous reliability and quality issues at the release, and since it was a completely new design, parts for it were unavailable, which meant that when it did break down, it would just end up sitting in the dealership, and this $50 little hatchback typically cost about $500 more than its American counterparts. But in all fairness, it did get above average gas mileage for the segment, and Volkswagen was quick to make updates, including additional shielding around the gas tank. And the Rabbit continued to be sold alongside the Beetle. But even so, Volkswagen's total U.S. sales in 1975 was less than 270,000, of which less than 250,000 of were cars. And they'd lost their title as the best-selling import brand by this point to both Toyota and Datsun. So naturally, we're advertising the Rabbit as the best-selling import car in Japan. The redesigned Corolla was less powerful, but was also better handling, had a smoother ride, and was geared to better handle American highways. Although it still took Toyota's complete lineup to outsell the Pinto, with their total U.S. sales of just under 330,000 and their total U.S. car sales under 285,000. Datsun had replaced the 1200 with the 210, which was slower, still not a highway car, had an interior that was less functional, but got better gas mileage. And Datsun sold almost 255,000 cars, all models combined, in the U.S. in 1975, with total U.S. sales of all vehicles of about 325,000. The Mitsubishi / Dodge Colt became a noticeable player in the segment, being bigger, smoother, and more powerful than the Japanese cars it was supposed to be competing against, although it was significantly more expensive. And the reason for this is because on the Japanese segment, it competed in a bigger, more powerful, more expensive segment. Honda was expanding its lineup, but the closest comparable thing it had to the Pinto at that time was the Accord. But soon, the Pinto would start getting bad press and seeing more competition from smaller, more economical cars, like the Chevy Chevette and the Renault LeCar. And Pinto sales would hit a low point of 130,000 in annual sales, but would soon add a V6, something that would cost you significantly more on an import model. And the car carried on until 1980, when sales had climbed back up to 190,000, in spite of the price climbing above $4,000. And where was its competition at this point? Well, the Vega was gone, although the Monza still carried on. The Gremlin had been replaced by the Spirit. The Colt had gotten smaller, more economical, and more expensive. Dodge was now offering the European-developed and powered Omni, and the Toyota and Nissan had grown to match it in both size and performance, but were now competing in a higher-priced market segment. For 1981, the Pinto would be replaced by the Escort, which would keep Ford in the lead of the American subcompact market through the end of the 80s. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to like and subscribe. Thanks.